Hello everybody, welcome to the special conference and number theory seminar this week. It's a great pleasure to introduce Josef Kussmaier. He's a student, he's a graduate student at the University of Vienna, and he will be speaking on elliptic and two analogs of Fibonomial numbers. So Fibonacci plus binomial, I suppose.
Thank you, Gaurav, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to talk here. I'm talking about elliptic and quinalogs of the Fibonomial numbers. And this is joint work with Nantel Bergeron and César Ceballos. Okay, what are the Fibonomial numbers, in case you haven't heard of them? So you take the binomial coefficient, for example, you write it down like this. You have n plus n, choose n, and you write the factors all out. And then how you get the Fibonomial numbers is that you just replace everything in numbers, number that is here, every number k you replace by the corresponding Fibonacci number fk. So you have fm plus n times fm plus n minus 1 and so on. And in the denominator you have fn, fn minus 1 and so on. So you replace every number by the Fibonacci number to obtain the Fibonomial numbers. And the Fibonacci numbers, they are, I just define them as f0 is 0, f1 is 1, and for n bigger or equal to 2, you have this recurrence relation. Yeah, and it turns out that the Fibonomial numbers are always integers. So we have a fraction of factorials, but they turn out to be integers. So for mn bigger or equal to 1, they are integers. So we can look for combinatorial interpretations. Of course, they are always positive. And the first combinatorial interpretation were given by Gesslin and Diano, I think in 1985, with some nests of lattice paths. And then Benjamin and Plott gave an interpretation in 2008 by some tilings, but both of the interpretations were quite complicated. And in 2010, or it was first published in 2009, I think, Sagan and Savage introduced a very nice interpretation, very simple. It's with lattice path and tilings. And some years later, in 2020, Bennett, Carrillo, Machacek, I don't know how to pronounce it, and Sagan, they gave a new combinatorial interpretation, which was quite nice because it also they could also deal with more things than just Fibonomials. They could also deal with Fibonacci factorials and also Catalan numbers, Catalan analogs. And what we are doing is that we take the model of Sagan and Savage and we do a Q and an elliptic analog of this model. So we give weights to this model to get a Q analog and an elliptic analog. We also did that for the model of Bennett, Carrillo, Machacek and Sagan, but that was a little bit more complicated and we didn't get the results that we wanted to have. So I will today stick to the Sagan and Savage model. Little outline of my talk today. So at first I will just talk about Fibonacci numbers and the analogs, a Q analog and the elliptic analog that we were doing, just to show you the whole procedure, how we are working. Afterwards, I will talk about the Sagan and Savage model for the Fibonomial numbers and show you how this works. I will show you how we did the analog, the Q analog, and also I will show you how we did the elliptic analog. And at the end, I will show you some open problems that are still open in this area. Okay, so let's start with the Fibonacci numbers. As I told you before, I defined them like that. So the usual definition, I think. And the Fibonacci numbers are counting a lot of things, but one of the things that they are counting is this. You take a rectangle of size n minus 1 times n, and you tile this rectangle with monominoes and dominoes. So monominoes are just these single tiles. I represented it as dots. So here's a monomino, and dominoes are these double tiles. I represented it with this line here. So we have here a domino, and we have also here a domino. And the number of tilings with monominoes and dominoes of this rectangle of size n minus 1 times n is just the nth Fibonacci number, which can be shown very easily by induction. we just look at the last tiling. It's either a monomino or it's a domino. If it's a monomino, you are left with a rectangle of size 1 less. And if it's a domino, you are left with a rectangle of size 2 less. So you get the recurrence relation. And you can also check the initial conditions, which are true for these tilings. Okay, so how do we do the Q analog? We just defined the Q analog of the Fibonacci number as the Q number of the nth Fibonacci number. So you may know the Q number, it's just you take the number and you just take 1 plus Q squared plus Q to the power of 3 and so on until you arrive at Q n minus 1. And we put in the Fibonacci numbers. So you arrive at Q to the power of fn minus 1. For the Q number of the nth Fibonacci number. So you don't only take the Fibonacci numbers here in the powers, but you take all the numbers from 1 to fn minus 1. Okay, so we have the Q analog of the Fibonacci number, and we can give weights to the tilings to get an interpretation of this Q number of the Fibonacci number. So for the monominoes, we just gave the weight 1. And for the dominoes, we give the weight q to the power of fi, so the ith Fibonacci number. And I is just the position of the right part of the domino. So here we have 1, 2, 3, 4. So this domino gets weight q to the power of f4. Then we go on 5, 6, 7. This domino gets the weight q to the power of f7.
Yeah, and to get...
yes?
I think x0 of q should be 0 as well. In the first
time. Yes. Oh, yeah. That's a mistake. Thank you. That's a typo here. This should be 0. Okay. And and to get the weight for the whole tiling, you just multiply all the weights. So here you have just 1 q to the f4, 1 q to the f7. So you get in total the weight for this tiling is q to the power of 16. Okay, and for f and q, we get the recursion that f and q is equal to fn minus 1 q plus q to the power of fn minus 1 times fn minus 2 q. And as a consequence of this recursion, we get that the q number of the nth Fibonacci number counts weighted tilings of size n minus 1 times n. And you just sum over all weights of all tilings of the rectangles of size n minus 1 times 1, and you get the Q number of the Fibonacci number. And this is also quite easily seen because either the last tiling is a monomino, not like here, then it gets weight 1, and we are left with a strip of size n minus 2 times 1. So we land here at the fn minus 1 Q by induction. Or it is a domino. Then the domino gets weight q to the f7 in this case, so in general q to the fn minus 1. And we are left with a rectangle of size fn minus 3 times 1, and we are landing here by induction fn minus 2 q. So this is very easily shown. And one example for n equals 5. We have a rectangle of size 4 times 1. And here are all the tilings for this rectangle. So we can tile it only with monominoes, for example, or we can give a domino here. We can have a domino here, we can have a domino here, and we can also have two dominoes at this size. These are the corresponding weights, q to the f2, q to the f3, q to the f4, and here we multiply q to the f2 and q to the f4. So in total, if we sum over all these weights of these tilings, we get the Q number of F5, which is 1 plus Q squared plus Q to the power of 3 plus Q to the power of 4. Okay, so now let's go on to the elliptic analogs. But before I talk about the elliptic analogs, I have to recall some definitions and some functions that we need. Very important for elliptic analogs and elliptic functions are the modified Jacobi theta functions. So you can see here the definition. It's an infinite product. You can also represent them as Pochhammer symbols if you are familiar to them. And if we have a multiplication of several theta functions, we just write it like that. So we just write 1 theta and all the arguments here. And the P is called the norm. we can write it like that. So all the arguments have to be not equal to zero, and the norm should have absolute value smaller than one for the modified Jacobi-Theta functions. And we need them for elliptic functions. I will show you later. So the theta functions, they have some very interesting fundamental identities. For example, if the norm is just zero, the only term that's left is 1 minus x. All the others cancel. Then we have this reflection formula, I guess we call it, that the theta function of xp is equal to minus x theta of 1 over xp. And we also have this quasi-periodicity condition that we, if we multiply x by p, if we have theta of p xp, then it's equal to minus 1 over x theta xp. And then also a very important thing for the theta function is this three-term identity due to Weierstrass, which looks like that. So we have a multiplication of theta function here and a product of theta function here and product of theta function here. So we have this three-term identity, which basically allows us to do combinatorics with the theta functions. So now an elliptic function, we finally arrived there, is just a doubly periodic meromorphic function on C. And there is this theorem, the factorization theorem about elliptic functions, that any elliptic function in G with period P and absolute value of p smaller than 1 can be factored in terms of theta functions. We also have this balancing condition for the a's and the b's. Yeah, and all the a's and b's should be in C and in the complex numbers, but not equal to zero. So, but what you need for the talk today maybe is just to know that if we have an elliptic function, we can write it as a product of a fraction of products of theta function. And we will see that later. Yeah, and elliptic functions, they seem to naturally generalize Q analogs. So for example, there exists the theory about elliptic hypergeometric functions, which generalize the basic hypergeometric function, also the ordinary hypergeometric function, of course. And they have a lot of applications, for example, to integrable systems where they first appeared in a paper of Frankel and Turev. And there are also various formulas, summation formulas, transformation formulas, integrals, and so on. Many things you can do with the basic hypergeometric function, you can also do a little bit more complicated with the elliptic hypergeometric functions. And there's also some combinatorics done with elliptic functions. For example, there exists elliptic enumerations of non-intersecting lattice paths and plane partitions in a work of Michael Schlosser, for example, or a work of Borodin, Gorin, and Reins. They gave weights to lozenge tilings, I think, which are also related to plane partitions, of course. And a lot have been done with special numbers and, for example, the elliptic binomial coefficients, Stirling numbers of the first and second kind, Lucas sequences in a quite new paper in the archive by Michael Schlosser and Miso Yu, but also La numbers, Rook numbers, and Fibonacci numbers. So this appears in a series of papers by Michael Schlosser together with Miso Yu and Kereskenye Balog. I don't know how to pronounce it, I'm sorry. And I wrote Fibonacci numbers there because there is already another interpretation of elliptic Fibonacci numbers or another definition of elliptic Fibonacci numbers. And we, in our paper, together with Nantel Bergeron and César Ceballos, we define them a little bit different. So I added this point here, elliptic Fibonacci numbers and elliptic Fibonomial numbers. And how the elliptic Fibonacci numbers are defined in our paper, I will show you now. So what I did is, what we did is just, we took the elliptic number of n. This is this comes from the work of Michael Schlosser, of his paper about the special case of the elliptic binomial coefficient. And it's defined as this product of theta functions, this product of fractions of theta functions. This is an elliptic function, I think in A and B and Q to the n. So. And what we did then is just replace the n by Fibonacci of n. So the same that we did with the Q number of the Fibonacci number, we do now with the elliptic number of the Fibonacci number. We take the elliptic number from this definition and we pull in the Fibonacci number fn. So we get this definition for the elliptic number of the Fibonacci number. And this is an analog of the Q analog, because if we take p equal p goes to 0, a to 0, and b to 0 in this order, we will be back at the Q analog of the Fibonacci number. So this is the Q analog is a special case, so to say. And if you take Q equal to 1, we will land at the Fibonacci number. So the Q analog is an analog of the Fibonacci number. So we have worked out this lemma for the elliptic number. So how do we add two numbers inside of the elliptic numbers? It's the m plus n is m plus some weight times n, and this weight is defined here. So you don't have to remember it very precisely, just that you know that we can pull this apart and have this weight here. This weight is dependent on m and n, and there are no shifts in the parameters there, which is also important. And we can also multiply two numbers inside the elliptic number and get this term. And there's here a shift. If you look closely, everything else is the same. Okay, and as a corollary, we get the recurrence relation for the elliptic Fibonacci numbers. So at first, I just replaced fn by fn minus 1 plus fn minus 2. Of course, this holds for n bigger or equal to 2. And then I use the lemma, the first part of it. And we get this weight here, the v of fn minus 1 and fn minus 2. So we get this recurrence relation. And maybe you already recognize how we will give the weights to the tilings that we had earlier. We give the weights as follows. If we have a monomino, we just give weight 1, like before. And if we have a domino, we give the weight of v of fi minus 1. And I is, again, the position of the rightmost cell of the domino. So here, for example, for this domino, we give the weight v of f7 and f6, just fi and fi minus 1. And here we have 1, 2, 3, 4, f4 and f3. And together with the recurrence relation, we have as a consequence that the elliptic number of the nth Fibonacci number counts elliptic weighted tilings inside the n minus 1 times 1 rectangle. So we just sum over all the weights in the rectangle, all the weights of all tilings in the rectangle, and we will end at the elliptic Fibonacci number. Okay, so that's it for the Fibonacci numbers. Now we can come to the Fibonomial numbers and their analogs. So now I define the Fibonomial numbers a bit more carefully. So the Fibonomial numbers are defined as, you have a m plus n, choose n, but with the f here, that means that it's a Fibonomial and not a binomial. So you take the, it's not the factorial, it's a Fibonomial. So you just multiply over all Fibonacci numbers that appeared before. So the Fibonomial of fn, for example, is just fn times fn minus 2 times fn minus 3, and so on until you land at f1. So all the numbers between fn and fn minus 1, they are not inside the Fibonomial. So this is just the Fibonacci analog of the factorial. So you have this definition, which is very similar to the binomial coefficient. You just replace the factorials by Fibonomials. And we also have a recurrence relation for the Fibonomials. So if you take m equal to 1, you will just get the n plus 1 Fibonacci number. And if you take n equals 1, you get the m plus 1 Fibonacci number. And for m n bigger or equal to 2, you get this recurrence relation. So m plus n choose n is in the Fibonacci setting is equal to f m plus 1 times f m plus 1 minus 1 n minus 1 Fibonomial plus fn minus 1 times m minus 1 plus n choose n in the Fibonomial setting. So this is also quite similar to the binomial coefficient. You also get a similar formula for a similar recurrence relation for binomial coefficients, just that you now have to multiply with Fibonacci numbers here. Okay, so let's come to the combinatorial model of Sagan and Savage that I told you before. So you take a m times n rectangle now. Earlier we had this n plus n minus 1 times 1 rectangle. We make a two-dimensional version of this now. So we have a rectangle. Here we have m cells, here we have n cells. So here it's a 5 times 4 rectangle, just that you know in which order I have m and where I have the n. Then we have a lattice path, which goes from the southwest to the northeast. If you just take that, we would just be at the binomial coefficients, if you know about that. But we want to have Fibonomial coefficients, so we have to do more. At first, we tile everything that's to the left of the lattice path with monominos and dominos, just like we did it before with the strip. But now every line is tiled separately. So here we can tile with monominos and dominos, here also, and here, and here. The next thing we do is that if we have here a little bit of space free, we also want to tile this space. The first thing we do is that under the lattice path, under every east step or right step, we put a domino. This will be called a special domino because it always has to be there. Not under the first steps where we are at height zero, so to say. There we cannot put a domino, but afterwards there always have to be a domino below that. So our lattice path, for example, cannot go like one step up and then to the right because it would not be possible to add a vertical domino there. So as you have seen, the dominoes are now vertical, not horizontal anymore. And we have still some space left and we tile this space also with dominoes and monominoes, and the dominoes are also vertical. So the columns here are all tiled separately. And it's also not too hard to prove that these tiles, so we are now done with the tilings, and it's not too hard to prove that these tilings are counted by the Fibonomial numbers. You just look at the recurrence relation, and at the model you look at the last step. So the last step can either be a west step like here, so a right step. Then you would be forced to put a special domino here and you have some space left. And this space is just a strip of size n minus 2. So the number of tilings for this space here is fn minus 1, as we have seen before. So we land at this here. And the rest, you are then left with a rectangle of size m minus 1 times n. So you get this Fibonomial. And the other case that can appear is that you have a north step at the end, and you will just land at this part here, as you can check if you want to. And we will call these tilings path domino tilings inside the m times n rectangle. Okay, and the theorem of Sagan and Savage says that the Fibonomial number counts the number of path domino tilings of an m times n rectangle. So the Fibonomial of m plus n choose n is equal to the number of tilings.
There was an m plus 1, f m plus 1 on the left one?
Yeah. Yeah, there's an m plus 1. Because if you go, if the last step is an up step, you have here a strip of size m times 1. And a strip of size m times 1 is counted by fm plus 1. Okay. Yeah, and what I wanted to say about the paper of Sagan and Savage is that they do a little bit more than just the Fibonomial coefficients. They do something that's called Lucas analogs, and they give also weights to the monomials and dominoes, but the weights are S and T for all dominoes and monomials, but I will not go into detail of that. But if you want to know more about it, then you can go to this paper. It's also very interesting, but we are not dealing with that because we are not generalizing the Lucas analog, but we are generalizing the Fibonacci, the Fibonomial. Okay, and one example for m and n equal 2, the Fibonomial turns out to be 6. And indeed, there are exactly 6 tilings of the 2 times 2 rectangle. So for example, you can go 2 steps right and then 2 steps up, and then you have 4 possibilities to tile these 4 cells. So either everything will be tiled with monominoes, or you can have a domino here, you can have a domino here, and you can also have 2 dominoes. Okay, if you go 1 step right and then up, you have to immediately go 1 step up again, because otherwise it would not be possible to put in the special domino here. And you have no choice about these cells here, because they're only only monominoes fit in there, because there are no vertical dominoes, there would be horizontal dominoes needed. And you can also go the step up at the beginning, and you also have to go immediately 2 steps up. So there's no choice left. We have only 1 tiling for this lattice path. And another example, if we just take n equal to 2 and m arbitrary, the Fibonomial will get us fm plus 2 times fm plus 1 on this side. And the tilings, they will give us the sum over all k equal to 1 until m plus 1 fk squared. And how this works? This works like I show you here. So at one point, you have to go up. If you go like the example here after the 3rd step up, then you have to go immediately 2 steps up, as I have told you before. And then you can just go to the right until you arrive at the end. Everything here is tied with the vertical special dominoes. And we have here some space left. So in this case, we have here a rectangle of size 3 times 2. And we tile every line separately, as I told you before. And so the number of tilings for this strip here would be F4, Fibonacci 4, and here also F4. So we get F4 squared. And for general M, this works exactly like this. So you have to go, at one point you have to go up, and then you go 2 up, and then immediately to the right. Then you get 2 strips, which you can tile, and you get FK squared for the number of tilings of these 2 strips. Okay, so we get this identity for Fibonacci numbers out of the Fibonomial numbers and the combinatorial interpretation of the Fibonomial numbers. And maybe you may have recognized this formula already, because there's another interpretation of this formula, which is very well known. So at the left-hand side, you can interpret this as the area of a rectangle of size fm plus 2 times fm plus 1. So in this example, I have m equal to 6. So this here is my fm plus 1, f7. This rectangle here has height f7. This is the square with f7 times f7. And this side of the rectangle has size f7 plus f6. So which gives f8, Fibonacci of 8. So we get this here. And this identity says that the area of this rectangle is equal to the area of all these squares of with lengths of Fibonacci numbers. So we can here at the center we start with a square of size f1 times f1, which just have size 1. Here is f2. Here we get f3 squared. So this is the area. Here we get f4 squared, f5 squared, f6 squared, and f7 squared. And this is an approximation also of the golden spiral, which also has many applications, I think, and also interpretations in physics and You see, Nautilus shells, for example, or hurricanes are working a little bit like this, like this spiral. So we got this formula out of the Fibonomial interpretation. Okay, now let's come to the Q Fibonomial numbers. So we define them very easily, very straightforward. You just replace every Fibonacci number now by the Q number of the Fibonacci number. So now we have the Q analog of the Fibonomial. Just multiply all the consecutive Q numbers of the Fibonacci numbers to get the Fn Fibonomial of Q. And we do the same as we have done with the Fibonomial, just we replace everything by the Q numbers. Okay, and we again get a recurrence relation, which is now not too easy to see how to get this, but still not a very big deal. So if m is equal to 1, we get the q number of the n plus 1 Fibonacci number. If n is equal to 1, we get the q number of the n plus 1 Fibonacci number. And we get this recurrence relation for m and n bigger or equal to 2. So we now have the q number of fn plus 1, but the q is shifted by fn. And here we get also the q number of fn minus 1, the q shifted by fm now, and we also have this additional q to the power of fm plus 1 times fn. Okay, and what we have done then is that we gave weights to the monominos and dominos again of the to the model of Sagan and Savage. So the dominos again, the monominos, sorry, again get always weight 1 like before. The dominos, the radical dominos, get the weight q to the power of fi times fj. And I is the x position and j is the y position. So here in this picture, I have already written down the Fibonacci numbers here. So this is Fibonacci number 1, Fibonacci of 2, the third Fibonacci number, the fourth and the fifth. So 1, 1, 2, 3, 5. These are just the Fibonacci numbers here. And here also, in this direction, 1, 1, 2, 3. So let's look at the vertical dominos. For example, this one here at this most, thousand most, has position 2, 2. In terms of Fibonacci numbers, this is just 1, 1. So this domino gets weight q to the power of 1. Then we go 1 up. This gets q to the 1 times 2. Gets weight q to the 2. This one here is 2 times 3, gets weight q to the power of 6 in this case. Then we have to give a little bit different weights to the vertical dominoes. Here for the normal vertical dominoes, they're not special ones. The weight is the same, fi times fj. So again here, we have 5 and 1. Q to the power of 5 is the weight for this vertical domino. And here for the special dominoes, we have to shift the weights a little bit. So we don't have fi times fj, but we have fi plus 1 times fj. The reason we have to do this is because of the recursion formula. It comes from this weight we have here in the front. So we have fn plus 1 times fn, and this would be the weight of this domino here, always the right bottommost. Yeah, and the proof all is again very similar. You do it by induction, or we did it by induction. As I have said before, you just have to check if all the weights are correct and if the initial conditions are correct. And it's straightforward then. Okay, in this example, then to get the weight of the whole tiling is just you multiply all the weights of the dominos and monominos. For example, here I just multiplied everything and got q to the power of 51. It's the weight of this tiling. Okay, and our theorem then says that if we sum over all weights of all tilings of the m times n rectangle, we land at the q Fibonomial. And what this theorem also says is that the q Fibonomials are polynomials in Q with non-negative integer coefficients, which is also a quite nice result, I guess. So one example again, the m and n equal to 2 For the qfi binomial, we get this polynomial here, 1 plus 2q plus 2q squared plus q to the power of 3. And if we tile all the 2 times 2 rectangles, we will see that this is exactly what we get if we sum over all these weights. And if you look at the coefficients here, then you may recognize here is a very simple example, but they seem to be a unimodal. And we have computed more of that. I think until m and n equal to 10, we have computed the coefficients and looked if they are unimodal, and they seem to be always unimodal. So we wrote down this conjecture in our paper that the polynomials are unimodal, and by polynomials are unimodal, I mean that the sequence of coefficients is unimodal. So they are increasing until some point and then decreasing until the end. This seems to be always the case, but we don't have a proof for that yet. Okay, again, the example with n equal to 2. Now we get a Q version of this identity for the Fibonacci spiral. So on the one hand, we have the product of fm plus 2q times fm plus 1q. And on the other hand, I have a sum over all fk squared. So like in this picture, and we have here a weight in front of every fk squared. So you can also interpret this as area. So here we have the area of fm plus 1 times fm plus 2, just with the q weight. And here we have the area of all the fq squared. So here f7 squared, f6 squared, f5 squared, and f4 squared. And we have also this additional q to the power of cmk now. And the cmk is just a sum over Fibonacci numbers. And if you look at the picture here, I wrote them down. The weights, they get bigger, or the exponents get bigger the nearer we are getting to the center of the spiral. So we were wondering ourselves if this can be interpreted maybe as some sort of density. So the Q in the front here, this weight, can be interpreted as some sort of density of the spiral maybe, because it makes sense that the spiral gets more dense if you go more to the center. And to approximate the mass of some physical objects in nature, like Nautilus shells, galaxies, or hurricanes. So this were a little bit out of our expertise, to be honest. So we left it as an open problem in our paper. And to introduce some density and maybe also to even make a continuous version of this, so to replace the sum by an integral, to get a physical interpretation of this. Maybe this has some physical meaning, if you want to think about that. So if you want to read about that, just go at our paper. There's some more information about it. So finally, the elliptic Fibonacci numbers, we do the same as we have done with the Q Fibonacci numbers. So we replace every Fibonacci number now by the elliptic Fibonacci number. Here, this is the elliptic analog of the Fibonacci factorial, the Fibonorial. Nothing new so far, just we replaced everything by the elliptic number. And we again get a recursion formula for the elliptic Fibonorial numbers. Here we have a shift. If you look carefully, we also had this shift in the Q case. And we have the weight, weight V here, which is an elliptic weight, and which is the thing that differs the most from the Q case. And we also get a combinatorial interpretation. We again give weights to the tilings. So still every monomino gets weight 1. So then every domino gets weight omega 1 of ij. Ij is the position of the tiling. So like, for example, here, the position is 1, 2, 3. Here are not Fibonacci numbers anymore, but natural numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4. So here we have position 3, the x position is 3, and the y position is 4. So this gets weight omega 1 of 3, 4. And the omegas are defined in terms of the reweights. And if you want to remember where the reweights come from, they come from this identity here in the cloud. So we had this identity. If we sum two numbers inside the elliptic number, we can also draw them apart, and we get this V weight here. And this weight we used to give the weights to the dominoes. So, okay, so it's there's nothing going on much more complicated than in the cube case, but a little bit you have to be careful about here. And for the vertical dominoes, it was the same weight for the vertical and the domino and the horizontal dominoes in the cube case. But now here in the elliptic case, we have to switch the J and the Y for the vertical dominoes. This is important. Otherwise, it would not be the same weight. And the weights for the special vertical dominoes are now quite a bit different. So it's, we called it omega 2, and omega 2 is defined again with the V that we had from this identity, but it looks a little bit different. So at the Q case, it looks very much the same, just a little bit shifted, but now it looks quite different, I would say. Okay, and we have the theorem again that the elliptic polynomial numbers, they count elliptic weighted path domino tilings. So if we sum over all weights of the tilings, we land at the elliptic Fibonomial. Okay, there's a little bit of typo. Typo, this should be the elliptic Fibonomials. Let's go with ABQP here as arguments. This is just a typo that I forgot to write them down. Okay, we could also do the spiral example again, but I chose to do a different example now for this talk here today. So there is one identity for the ordinary Fibonomials, which there was a proof by Rayland, which worked with the combinatorial interpretation of Sagan and Savage. So we thought that it would be natural to generalize this to the elliptic and the cube case, and it was indeed possible. So she had a proof for this identity. We adapt this proof for the elliptic setting, and we landed at this identity, so that the elliptic Fibonomials of m plus n choose n is equal to this sum, this convolution formula, one could say. We have here a lot of elliptic Fibonacci numbers, here we have elliptic Fibonacci numbers, here a weight, and here elliptic Fibonomials. Just to see one example, what one can do with this. Okay, now let's come to the open problems section. One can ask, so I will stick to the Q Fibonomials now. So one can ask, what other products of ratios of Q Fibonomials can we take? So for example, the Q Fibonacci analog of the nth Catalan number is defined as, so you take the Q Fibonomial of n plus n choose n, and you divide it by the n plus 1th Fibonacci number, the Q version of it. And so it's proven that it's a polynomial in Q with integer coefficients for n bigger or equal to 1. But we could not prove that the coefficients are always non-negative integer coefficients. This would be, for example, possible with a combinatorial interpretation and the generating function proof. And in the paper of Bennett, Carrillo, Mashathek, and Sagan in 2020, they found the combinatorial model for the Fibonacci analog. So if you take Q equal to 1, so there is a model for this Fibonacci analog of the Catalan numbers, but we were not able to generalize it to the Q case. So this is still an open problem to show if these polynomials always have non-negative integer coefficients. I think this was also the question that was asked 2 weeks ago here in the seminar, if products of ratios of Q factorials have non-negative integer coefficients. Now we have Q Fibonomials instead of Q factorials. So we can ask exact the same questions. The same is true for the rational Catalan numbers. If you take the MN Catalan number and the Q version of it. So you take the Q Fibonomial of M plus N choose N, and you divide it by the Q number of the F of the Fibonacci number of M plus n. Again, we can show that this is a polynomial in Q. This proof was given by Xu Xiao Li in a seminar at the Fields Institute in New York, I think. So they worked together with Nantel Bergeron and César Ceballos. And he showed this proof, but then he didn't work anymore in this problem, I think. So we have written it down in our paper now, and it appears there. But again, we cannot show that these polynomials always have non-negative integer coefficients. And not even in the Q equal 1 case, there is a combinatorial interpretation of this term. So also this appears to be an open problem still. So find a combinatorial interpretation of this term here, or the ordinary Catalan numbers, is still an open problem. Okay, and here I have some references. This new paper by Bennett, Carrillo, Mashezek, and Sagan, you can find at the archive, for example, or here it appears in the Annals of Combinatorics in 2020. Our paper appeared at Sigma, I think in July or in August of 2020. And the paper of Sagan and Savage, where you find the model appeared in Integers. You can also find it in the archives, and all the other references that I have used today, you can find in our paper if you just go to the references there. Okay, thank you much for your attention.
Thank you, very nice talk. Me very clearly presented.
Thank you.
Any questions? Okay, I have one question. Shur had Q Fibonacci numbers. Shur defined some Q Fibonacci numbers which were related to the Rogers-Ramanujan identities. So, to some finite form or something. So, have you looked at those kind of things with your Q Fibonacci numbers?
I think so. What we have worked out for the Q Fibonacci numbers, I could work out with my Q Fibonacci numbers. Uh-huh. I haven't looked at this so far, no. I tried to put his Q Fibonacci numbers in the Fibonorials, so to take in the Fibonomials, uh-huh. But these are not always polynomials, I think. That was the problem with these numbers for the Fibonomials, I think.
What about elliptic generalization of the Schur type of things?
I haven't tried out this, no.
Because they have a very similar thing, and there was one talk in our seminar long back where he was using tiling to give some kind of alternate proof of the Rogers-Ramanujan identity. So I'll send you a link to that.
Okay, so, thank you.
In my work with Miso Yu, we have elliptic analog or elliptic extension of the Schur type of Fibonacci numbers.
Oh, I see.
So that's, yeah. So that's the difference. Yeah.
Yeah. So this elliptic Fibonacci numbers that I used, they gave this very nice recursion formula for the Fibonomials. That's why I used them. Yeah. That was the main reason.
Any other questions or queries?
Hi, Joseph. Lovely hi. Talk. Especially that thought bubble that you drew, as in the cloud, you called it the cloud. Really cool. Huh? You needed to get reminded and you put it in a bubble. So very nice. The other thing was that, of course, you have been referring to the positive coefficients coming from combinatorial interpretation. So that was probably standard. I mean, but the unimodality that you were referring to, that is more puzzling and, what do you, have you seen it in other situations and why do you conjecture that way? That's my question.
So the reason why we conjectured this, I think that I have not seen that, but Nantel Bergeron told me that if we have the unimodality condition, so if we could prove the unimodality, and then the positive coefficients of the rational, so this would be for free more or less. So he has a proof if the Q Fibonomials are unimodal, or the coefficients are unimodal, then these polynomials must have non-negative integer coefficients. I think that's the main reason why we conjectured that.
Okay, so it has come up in some other papers, you're saying? Or he has a proof which he might...
I think he has this proof at his table, but I have not seen it yet. We have not talked about it.
Fine, fine. Let's hope it comes out in paper.
Yeah.
Sure, thanks.
Okay, any other comments or questions?
Hello.
Hello.
Very interesting. And Fibonacci numbers are everywhere, you know. In quantum information theory, they use Fibonacci numbers a lot. Grassell and Scott have very good papers. And other people which relate to number theory. And an expository article I have on archive. My name is Ajit Iqbal Singh. Fibonacci fervor in linear algebra and quantum information theory. And one can see okay. that as a little introduction to a lot of applications in linear algebra and quantum information theory. Also, Sudipto Singha Roy at Harishchandra Research Institute, in his PhD thesis, he has related Fibonacci numbers to the resonance valence bond states. And that is a very interesting account, you know. And also Manjil Saikia and his co-author, they have Fibonacci numbers. So I don't know if they have Fibonacci polynomials or not. That you have to check. But Manjil Saikia has very nice papers on Fibonacci. And thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for your comment. I will look this up.
Okay, any other comments or queries? Okay, then let's thank the speaker. Thank you again, Yusuf. Very nice talk.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.